Good morning, one and all. And I'm so grateful for getting this opportunity to be the part of this talk. And it's a lively day today with the pleasant weather. And it's a great pleasure for me to introduce to you guys with our guest speaker, Professor Dr. Neeraj Taneja. Professor Dr. Neeraj Taneja is a graduate of KLE Dental College, Belgaum, 1998. After completing his post-graduation in oral medicine and radiology from SDM College of Dental Sciences, Dharwad, he did his MBA from Punjab School of Management Studies, Punjabi University, Patiala in 2017 and PhD diploma in forensic sciences from Punjabi University in 2008. Now pursuing a PhD in clinical research from Galgotia's University, Greater Noida since 2017. He has been a professor with 16 years of experiences in dental college. His specialty areas include clinical research, oral medicine and radiology, orofacial pain, forensic odontology, and oral cancer. He has published more than 30 scientific publications and more than 50 paper presentations to his credit in various national and international conferences. He had been a guest speaker in various international and national conferences. He has a keen interest in clinical research, pharmacovigilance, clinical trials, forensic odontology, and oral cancer. He had been conducting various hands-on workshops on bite marks. He has been conferred fellowship in forensic odontology by the Indian Board of Forensic Odontology in 2015 and also received an Excellence Award in Forensic Odontology by the Indian Health Professional Awards. Then he has been conferred upon Promising Dental Leadership Award in 2018, Pencosomia Talents of Healthcare Awards. He has organized the 14th National Conference, Indian Associations of Forensic Odontology in September 2016, which was attended by 950 plus delegates, and the 6th INPAFO World Conference on Forensic Odontology in 2019. And it was held at Chandigarh, which has keynote speakers from 12 different countries and was attended by 550 plus delegates. He is a founder member of the Indo-Pacific Academy of Forensic Odontology in PAFO and the ex-vice president of the Indian Association of Forensic Odontology. Then currently he is serving as an advisor to the INPAFO. He is also managing editor of the journal Indian Academy of Oral Medicine and Radiology, Scopus Index. Thank you so much, sir, for accepting our invitation and sharing your time and sharing your knowledge with all the learners. And we are looking forward to this particular session.
Thank you over so much, Sugandha.
Thank you so much, sir.
I would like to thank Dr. Ranjit Singh for giving me this opportunity. So now we start, already delayed by 20 minutes, but no issues. The topic for today is bite mark unleashing the power in me. What is the power in the bite marks and how they should be recorded and presented in the court? Like all these topics will be covered in today's talk. Yeah. The important thing to know is the criminal may lie through their teeth, but the teeth themselves don't lie. Note, we also understand, and the bite marks are based on the principle that no two mouths are alike. These are the two things we have to keep in mind before going further. And to discuss, today we'll discuss the perspective and challenges involving bite mark, and to make about the minimum requirement for recording and preserving the bite mark. This is important because ultimately we record bite marks to present in the court of law. And we should know how to record and how to preserve that so that they should be accepted in the court of law. Otherwise, there's no point. Bite mark evidence assists the judicial system to answer the crucial questions about the interaction of two people at the crime of C. Also, based on the dental unique pattern for individualization to find out who is the culprit, whether the accused is really a culprit or not. Also, to play a crucial role in solving rape and child abuse cases and to describe the level of violence in the crime. Definition, as per definition, McDonald's had defined bite marks as the marks caused by the teeth either alone or in combination with other mouthparts. Whereas ABFO, American Board of Forensic Odontology, has described the defined bite mark as physical alteration of or representative pattern recorded in a medium caused by the contact of a human of a teeth or an animal. And in general language, we say it's a pattern produced by human or animal dentition and associated structure, teeth and associated structure in any substances of being marked by these means, capable of being marked by these means. Now, to start with, there are three different types we normally see. Some are clear bite marks, some are obvious, and whereas others are noticeable. Going further for the classification, they are classified on the base of manner of causation. Like, they are criminal bite marks, they are non-criminal, like love bites. Criminal bite marks are normally offensive upon the victim by the assailant, or defensive upon the assailant by the victim. The other classification, offensive means they are well-defined pattern, usually singular pattern associated with arousal, and most often post-mortem. Defensive are not well-defined pattern, multiple bite patterns used as defense against the assault or repeated bite. Like, some two people are fighting and the victim normally causes a defensive type of bite marks. Guftason in 1996 defined this as a sadistic or sexual bite, aggressive bite, or most aggressive bite. Cameron and Sims classification includes depends on agents like human or animal, material, skin, body tissue, foodstuff, other material. And in 1979, McDonald also classified this on the basis of etiologies. What type of etiology it involves, that is the tooth pressure marks, tongue pressure marks, tooth scrape marks, and complex marks, like the combination of tooth or tongue scrape and pressure marks. By degree of abrasion, if we classify this, they could be hemorrhage, like undamaging mark on the skin, abrasion, contusion, like rupturing the blood vessels, laceration, punctured or torn skin, incision, avulsion, removing of the skin from the body, and artifact, like bitten off piece of a skin. By degree of definition, there could be a significant abrasion. They are called as clearly defined. They could be violent, which could be lacerated. They're obviously defined, like a first degree pressure, or they could be quite noxious, that means really violent type. Other classification includes sexually bite oriented, child abuse cases, and self inflicted bite. How do we identify the bite marks? So they are identified on the basis of their features, could be a gross, class, or individual feature. Gross features include circular elliptical bite marks, and central area ecchymosis, that is sucking action. Class fixtures, like differentiate between the tooth type, rectangular, triangular, whether they are by canines, premolars, or pointed, or based on the basis of the attrition of the teeth. Individual fixtures means fracture of the teeth, either any of the tooth is rotated or any spacing is there, like midline spacing. These are the class characteristics, where you can have different types of shape, tooth alignment, thickness, weight, spacing, missing teeth. Site. Female usually are bitten on the breast, abdomen, thighs, and buttock and pubis. Whereas men are normally bitten on arms and shoulders. Self-defensive victim normally bite on the hands and the arms of the assailant. What are the different factors that affects the bite? The different factor that affects the bite marks include site variation, which site the bite marks are present. They are on the arms, they are clearly visible. They are on the cheeks, they are clearly visible. They're on the chin, they might not be that visible. Curvature of the surface, dragging during the bite process, that means scraping type of a bite marks. Structure and vascularity of the tissue. Time-dependent changes, environmental, and medication. We'll go one by one. Type of tissue. If the tissue is loose or fat, bruising will lead to a poor definition. Fibrous tissue with high muscle contents, the definition will be good and bruising will be less. Infant and old bruise more than the older age group because their skin is soft. So the bite marks are more clearly defined on those parts. Female tend to bruise more than the males. And once produced, evidence for longer period of time in female as compared to the males. In males, the bite mark disappears early than the females. Medical status, if the person is having bleeding disturbances or under anticoagulant therapy, bruising will be more. And time, depression produced in the skin due to bite marks will recover within 10 to 20 minutes, leaving swelling and discoloration. And after that, skin tends to contract, so harden and decompose. So time becomes important while recording the bite marks. Other factors are location of the body. Size, shape of the bite mark is affected by the location. Certain areas bend, distorting the surface of the skin due to high viscoelasticity. Clothing, some bite marks are through the clothes, whereas others are not. So through the clothes, the definition would be less. But without the clothes, we can collect the other major evidence, that is biological evidence like saliva transfer. Similarity in definition among the individual, photography, impression, how do we record, how do we take the impression, how do we measure the dentition characteristics. Distortion. There are mainly two different types of distortion, that is dynamic distortion and tissue distortion. The primary, when it occurs at the time of the biting, and the secondary, when the bite mark is examined. So at both times, the distortion can take place. These are of three types, time-related, posture-related, and photographic distortion. Longer the time interval after the mark is made, less distinct the mark could be in both living and the dead. In living, bruising occurs, and in the dead, the body begins to decompose and shrinkage occurs due to rigor mortis. If you look at these pictures, the bite marks immediately after the episode are more clearer than 5 minutes after the episode. And if you look at 20 minutes after the episode, they are rarely visible, but later on one mark, you can see the blood spots and see the impressions of the bite marks. So timing is very important. How do we deal with the bite mark cases step by step? We have to understand four different stages. First, the description of the bite marks, collection of the bite marks, collection of the evidence from the suspect, and bite mark comparison. And all these four stages are very important. Description means you get a call from the police authorities to record a bite mark. The first and the foremost thing is you have to record the name, age, sex, race, case number, date of examination, who are going to examine, who are going to record the bite marks. They become really very, very important. And describe the anatomic location, indicate the contour of the surface, whether it's flat, curved, or irregular, state the tissue characteristics, what type of skin it is affixed, mobile, any underlying bone tissues visible or not, then cartilage, muscles, and fat. Shape of the bite mark, whether it's round, ovoid, crescent, or irregular in shape. Then the color, horizontal, vertical dimension should also be recorded in a metric system. And then type due to bite marks, maybe petechial hemorrhage, contusion, abrasion, laceration, and other things, etc., should be recorded carefully. How do we collect the data from the victim? First and the foremost thing is a visual examination. What type of injury it looks like? Is the victim dead? Or the visual examination must be done before the autopsy. After autopsy, there's no point of visual examination. And you have to record the contour, physical appearance. ABFO has issued a guideline for the photography and the salivary swabbing. How do we do it? And we have to do in almost all the cases. Orientation and the close photograph should be taken. It should be taken at the angle of 90 degrees. With or the without presence of scales, placed adjacent to the bite mark. It's always advised to place a scale like ABFO number 2 or NNDV number 2 scale. We'll be doing these scales also today. adjacent to the bite mark. If in case you don't have that scale, you can have a normal ruler on the nearby the bite mark, but make sure the angle of the camera lens should be 90 degree to the scale, should be placed adjacent to the bite mark, parallel to the floor, and angle of the camera should be 90 degree to the floor and the bite mark. They should be in the scale and the bite mark, as I said, it should be in same place. Should include linear and circular reference also. You can put a coin nearby to have a circular reference so that there should not be alteration or in recording and clicking the pictures. Resolution should be high quality with proper color balance. Serial photographs are recommended by living victim colors. Both colors as well as black and photograph should be are recommended in this. Another important thing is you have to collect the saliva, whether it is present or not. You have to try to collect and do the whatever testing is required. This saliva thing is very important. We'll in the end, I'll tell you how that is important. Impression of the bite mark should be taken very carefully. Material should meet the specification. Suitable support should be included while recording. Like the bite mark should be hand. If it is on the arm should be kept on a stable tabletop or anything that is stable. There should not be any movement while taking the impression. Tissue sample should be retained even it appears that they may yield useful information. Coming to the scale, this scale is ABFO, American Board of Forensics, and number 2 scale. Now the important thing is here there are two different planes, the horizontal and the vertical planes. There are 3 different circles seen on this, which would tell us about the angle in which the photograph has been taken. Okay. This is how we keep the scale while taking the photograph. They should be on the same plane, and so that when we measure it using the softwares, we should not have any problem at that time. This is NNDV scale. This was designed by a very dear friend of mine, Emilio. And this is almost similar to the ABFO scale, but the difference is it has given a color coded of the bite mark. That if it is red, it means average age of the bite mark is 0 to 2 years. If it is blue, it means the average age of bite mark is 2 to 5 years. The purple is 2 to 5 days, not years, sorry. Green is 5 to 7 days, yellow is 7 to 10 days, and brown is 10 to 4 days. Have to be, this is called as calorimetric scale. This is the article where you can read about this scale. How to take the impression of the bite mark? Use a soft putty using polyvinyl, polysiloxane, polyether, other impression available in all the dental offices. Allow the impression to accurately record the curvature of the skin. Then put a gauze piece over that impression. And then you can put a dental acrylic or plus plaster to make it a little harder when you take it out, more rigid. These are the 3-step technique. Saliva should be obtained from the bite mark whenever it is possible. Double techniques should involve. Take the motion, the side with the swab, motion with the sterile solution, and take the saliva. Then remove the moisture with the second dry swab, and both the swabs are sent for analysis. First, you moisten the swab, put it on that, and then dry that moisture with the other swab and send both the swabs for this thing. How do we examine the suspect? The third important part while recording the bite mark evidence. History of dental treatments after and just before the bite mark has to be noted. Full face, frontal occlusal, lateral views, photographs to be taken. TMJ stated, muscle tone, maximum opening of the mouth, deviation, opening, closing. All this movement should be recorded. And lastly, the saliva swab should be performed with the permission of the court. Last stage is very important. Compare and identify. Relationship. First thing is, how do you compare that? First, you have to see the relationship of the jaw. Then you have to obtain the dental charting, the whole odontogram to be taken, record any missing teeth, any spacing, evaluation of the size of the teeth, prominence of the teeth, special features such as fracture or ridges or rotation should be taken, presence of supernumerary teeth, any form and size of the arches, width of the teeth, observe the rotations, presence, special, all the class as well as individual characteristics to be recorded. Bite mark analysis. Recording and analyzing are two different things. How do we analyze? We have recorded, we have taken the impression, we have taken the photograph, colored, black and white and everything. And then we need to record the bite. After recording, we have to analyze it. The discovery, this is important for discovery and preservation of the evidence. And then evaluate, compare the finding. And how to write the report. Now, important thing to understand here is the bite mark analysis is not the same as bite mark comparison. These are two different things. First, you have to analyze this, what is present, what evidence has, what is the evidence present in the recorded bite mark, and then you can compare with the accused. This evidence you can compare with the accused and whatever other evidence is available. Nothing but a bite mark analysis, nothing but a patterned injury and the circumstances surrounding it to be taken into consideration. Frequently yield valuable information that forensic will not testify in the court of law. You have to have visit the you have to have go to the crime scene to understand what is the surrounding, so that you can better corroborate the evidence in the court of law. Whatever you analyze and then to identify and then to compare, then ultimately aim is to corroborate in the court of the law. And you have to make sure the interpretation of those findings are based on the experience, training and circumstances of the event. For that, you need to see what was the circumstances at the time of crime. Bite mark cases, analysis is in bulk. Most important role is of forensic odontology, and bias should be avoided and should be done before any suspects are introduced to purpose of making of comparison. Means you get the bite mark, don't think about the accused or what the police have arrested. You have to understand that, visit, understand the crime scene, how it could have happened, then record the evidence, analyze the evidence. And then after analyze the evidence, record the bite marks of the accused, and then you start comparing with that. Just don't jump into the conclusion in a hurry. Now, while analysis, you have to process in all this, answering basic and some crucial questions. And some of the questions are really very, very important. Now, the first question that was it made by an adult or a child? What is it? First thing is you have to make sure whether it's by human or an animal. Then what is it is made by the adult or the child? And swab taken for DNA or not taken? Was it made through clothing or not? Whether the clothes swab for DNA taken or not? When the bite was inflicted in relation to the time of death? Is it fresh scar or somewhere? You can use NNDV scale for that. Was the person bitten alive or dead at the time? Or are there any unique dental characteristics seen to exclude the possible suspects later on? Where is the position that is located on the victim's body? Could it have been self-inflicted or by the accused? Who could be the possible biter? Was it offensive or defensive? And in case of multi-bite, do the same for all the bite marks. You have to establish the pattern of a long-term abuse. Now, coming to the analysis, there are more than 20 different matters. We'll be doing a few important matters to compare. The most common methods out of these 20 are to compare the acrylate overlay manually fabricated from the study model. And you take a study model of the accused, put that model on the overlay, press it, take the x-rays, photograph and compare it. Comparing the study model to a life-size photograph of the wound. This is most commonly used method that we are doing nowadays. Comparing an acrylate overlay manually fabricated from the bite in the wax or to a photograph of the wound. Compare the acrylate overlay manually fabricated from the x-ray of a radiographic material placed in the wax bite. and compare the acylate overlay manually fabricated from the photocopy of the wound and photocopy of the accused tip. Other commonly are hand trace bags, hand trace casts, computer based. 3D scanning is nowadays becoming very commonly. These are the odontometric triangle method. This is triangle is made on the tracing of the bite marks at teeth model by bite mark marking 3 points, 2 on the outer and the most convex part of the canines, the one in the center of the upper central incisor, and then compare these angles. Second is metric analysis. Use a vernier caliper or digital vernier caliper, manual or digital, or computer digital method to see the width of the edges of the teeth. Then there's a pattern. Take the scale, model from the suspect, direct method. Suspect models are placed directly, the cast are placed directly over the inflicted wound and see whether they are superimposing or not. This is pattern association. Then is radio opaque wax pattern, like take a impression of the cast on the wax sheet, put a radiographic radio opaque material on that, take the x-ray and put this x-ray on the self bite marks on the victim and then compare. Overlay methods are prints are made on the bite marks photos, casts are made along with the bite mark occlusal surface, and then overlays are placed on the bite mark and compare. And when the clear plastic sheets, the OHP sheets can be used for this, like this, hand trace from the cast. Now, other is a fold a styrofoam plate in the half, how to take impression. One label as maxilla, other is mandible, the lower one is mandible. Gently bow the plate on the leaf, plate to leave your bite mark impression. Place a sheet of the plastic film over the impression and use a permanent marker to recreate the pattern to the match your bite mark. Then use a ruler to make the measurement shown and recording in the table along with any notes regarding unique characteristics. This is how we compare them width and then the depth. Another method is like we record the fingerprints. Okay. Fingerprint lifting tape can be used to lift the perforating bite marks. Put a powder, fingerprint lifting powder on the bite marks. Use the tape and then take them. You can compare that with the cast of the accused. Now, very important method is computer-based method. Normally, nowadays, we are using digital method. We record the bite marks, take the pictures, and lift the bite marks from the victim, take the bite marks, cast for the accused, lift the bite marks from that, and then compare using computer overlay method. Nowadays, there's softwares available in the market, and they cost somewhere around 16 to 20 lakhs. Some are now have come like 8 to 10 lakhs also. They use a scanner. Just like we take impression and scan those crown cutting impression and the lab people are scanning them and send it to bigger labs. So similarly, we can record this. 3D scans of the dental casts are used to generate the overlay using various pressure and deviations. And then these overlays are compared with the photographs of the bite marks. They are more scientific, more quantitative, and 3D pictures and bite marks can be recorded with this. There are intraoral scanners available for this purpose. And then the other method is scanning electron microscopy, which is to detect the individual characteristics. Acrylic and epoxy impression of the bite mark and impression will be prepared, coated with carbon to make them conducive to electric beam. Scan the specimen in three different dimensions. And then scanning SEM study is done on that. This is how we measure and compare the bite marks. Now, these were the perspectives which we have discussed. Now, there are few challenges in this. And recently, last almost half of decade or almost a decade, there has been a criticism for this bite mark analysis. It has been questioned as a reliable scientific tool. Okay. Now, why this is questioned? Because distortion which occurs, numerous methods of fabrication, manual, computerized, and all that. And there could be error while recording the bite marks. This mostly relies on manual methods, taking cast from the accused, taking pictures with the camera. So there are chances of human error. There are more chances of human error rather. Subjective element in fabrication of this bite mark, then there's a subjective element in comparison of that. Due to all this, there's a lot of criticism recent days. So as a result, this has been suggested that bite mark analysis using acetate overlays are inaccurate, subjective, and non-producible. Problem is, there could be a movement of victim and the accused when the bite marks are being transferred at the time of crime. Human skin is not a good recording medium. Healing power of the human skin, I mean, you have very less time to record and do deformability and elasticity of the human skin. These are the problem in analysis. Now, this picture is taken from a very good article which has challenged the bite mark. Now, these are the bite marks taken. The bite marks are in black, whereas biter's overlay are in blue. Look at the difference of the bite marks. These are the bite marks seen at the time of crime when the pictures were taken. And these were the taken from the accused teeth. Now these are the overlay one. So bite mark was inflicted with the arm straight at the side. A pattern was recorded when the arm was positioned over the head. That's why there is a difference in both the bite mark and the biter's overlay. You can understand that the position of the arm has changed, and this position while recording and when taking the overlay has changed the bite mark's appearance totally. So this is important that when the bite mark was transferred to the victim, what was the position at that time? Otherwise, there's an alteration. Other challenges, indistinguishing from similar dentition. Three-dimensional model of two different people in which six anterior teeth were found to have a same 3D image. These two casts are from two different people. Now, in the first slide, I have said that the principle of bite mark is unique identification of the teeth. Now, in this picture, the 3D model, 3D, which we consider as more accurate, the 3D model, the six anterior teeth are found to be same based on the measurement determined by the repeated measurement. These are found to be same. This is two identical bite marks, but presenting a different picture because of the movement. The lower has been distorted. Outlines of the same set of teeth, but the perimeter shapes are different. You can see this. They are the same teeth, but the shapes are different. So due to all these challenges, there's a lot of criticism on the bite marks, but that does not rule out the science behind the bite marks. The only thing is, this is due to the lack of experience in the skill, lack of proper equipment, because cost effectiveness that is involved, poor awareness among the police. These are the major challenges and the hurdles. But the word says impossible, I am possible. If you have a great experience, great knowledge, you have a proper equipment with them, and you are allowed to use that, and the police and all are highly trained about these things. Now, if you see, look at the India picture. Very few districts out of 700 plus districts India is having, very few districts have a forensic odontology on the police panel. Forensic scientists are doing the same. They are not, they might be trained, might not be highly trained in recording and preserving the evidence. Okay, these are the few challenges. We were at the report, and how do we write the report? The reports are to be written in a very specified manner. If it is a positive identification, sufficient uniqueness among the comparable items. This should be written. Sufficient uniqueness. You are not a judge to write, yes, this bite mark belongs to this person. You are not supposed to say that in the court of law. because these things are very sensitive and this can play with somebody's life. Maybe he's a criminal, maybe he's not. So these has to be corroborated with other evidence. So as a forensic odontology, if you find a positive identification, you write positive identification, there's some sufficient uniqueness. There are other factors in the case also. There may be probable identification means high level of concordance among the data that may lack the radiographic support. Presumptive or possible identification is enough information may be missing from the either source. Insufficient identification means there's insufficient supportive evidence in this particular two samples, what you have compared as a forensic odontology. Exclusion of identification means they are clearly not of same people, clearly inconsistent. So this is the way the report should be written. So ABFO has a comparison analysis and comparison algorithm where there's a question pattern. Question pattern injury, it's a bite mark. See whether it's a human or animal. Let's say it's a human. Is it a human bite mark? It is inconclusive. You are not able to make out whether it's a human or an animal. Assuming it is human bite mark, you see sufficient evidentiary value for comparison is there or is not there. If it is not there, forget it. If it is there, then you go further with the comparison. If it is human bite with sufficient evidentiary value, comparison to the subject dentition. Now, here at this point, you should think about the subject and start comparing. And to be more precise, always make sure two different identification and verification should be done. One, the person who has been allotted by the police. Second, totally independent verification. Dentition excluded as having made the bite marks. Dentition not excluded having made the bite marks and inclusive. So this is the three-way report they give it. Whether this dentition does not belong to the accused, this dentition does not exclude the accused, or this is totally inconclusive. This is latest we are following. Now, how reliable, as we discussed, bite mark analysis assumption that dental characteristics are involved, that we discussed, this asserted uniqueness is transferred and recorded. This is the basic principle we talk about. But as an additional evidence and uniqueness of the bite mark, these should be normally corroborated with additional evidence like presence of accused at the crime scene, DNA samples, and how you present your case and survive the cross-examination. This is an art. Because in the court of law, the accused defense evidence will definitely ask you so many questions and you have to answer precisely what has been asked. So you should be sure about your conclusions. Rest depends on the honorary justice. Like in Nirbhaya case, you all must be aware of. In that, there were so many bite marks on that on the body of the victim. So many bite marks. And out of that, three bite marks, many bite marks, around 50 plus bite marks were taken. But out of those, three accused bite marks were found to be conclusive. There was Dr. Ashit Acharya who did this, and he was called to the court of law and he gave his recorded his statement and evidence and answered the question of the defense. But that was one part of the crime. Those were corroborated with other evidence. That's how they got the death sentence. Only they totally did not dependent on that. This is one part of the bite mark. Other part is Innocence Project. If you Google it and you see Innocence Project, there's a Keith Howard case, and there are many such cases involving bite marks where Keith Allen Howard walked out of Virginia prison in 2016 after serving 33 years of life sentence for rape and murder, which he did not complete. He was convicted on the basis of bite marks. Some NGO started Innocence Project, went through all the recordment, went through the statement that were recorded in them, and the samples that were preserved were taken for reanalysis with the DNA. And 30 years before, DNA was not a technology that was used so often. So now that can be used. So they got, with the permission of the court, DNA analysis was done. And then he was released from the prison, but he served 30 years old. So this is a very sensitive science. So you need a lot of expertise. Just to end this, there are a few courses. To be a good forensic odontologist, you should be a good dentist first. You should have a good clinical experience. Create your contacts in the police and medical examination office. Work with professionals in forensic odontologists. Have some training. Courses are available in India, but Dental Council of India do not recognize MSc forensic odontology, which many private universities are. But these are good courses for the people who want to learn this science. UGC recognizes this MSc course. Talks are definitely going on in Dental Council of India that MDS in forensic odontology should be started so that all the courses should be recognized. And there are talks going on to have a forensic council of India. I think they have started one recently. Courts, government sector specialist can be called as a witness. Private sector has to follow the rules. Private expert can give witness, like Ranjit sir is doing that since many years. He's a private, he owns a private company which does some forensic analysis for different things, handwriting, fingerprinting, dental also. And they are giving evidences, presenting evidence in the court of law. But with the permission of the court, they are allowed to do that. Again, in the end, truth will remain a truth. Criminals can lie to their teeth, but their teeth will not rarely lie. So thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. Thank you, Ranjit sir, and SIFS. Any questions? Your questions are... Thank you, audience, for your patience and your attention.
Thank you so much, sir, for a wonderful talk. Now, I request Afreen before taking the session to take over the charge session.
Thank you so much, sir, for giving me this opportunity.
Thank you.
And a very big thank to Neeraj, sir, for being with us today and delivering a session on bite mark, which could be an unleashing power within itself. So I'll request my co-host, Sugandha, to give a vote of thanks to Neeraj, sir, and all the participants.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, sir. It was a very knowledgeable session because I also belong to the same field. So it was very intellectual from your side.
Thank you, sir.
So even I enjoyed the session very much. So I think the audience would have also enjoyed it. And they are... they'll also be learning very sort of experiences you have shared by giving the admissibility of the bite marks in the court and by sharing your practical knowledge regarding the bite marks analysis. So on the behalf of SIFS and all the participants, I am extremely thankful to you for giving your valuable time to us and embrace the knowledge with your intellectual insights on this topic. Thank you so much, sir.
Thank you so much, Sugandha. Thank you so much once again, Neeraj, sir. I'll request participants, if we have any questions for Neeraj, sir, we can definitely have it in the session. So participants, do we have any question? You have an opportunity to write in the chat box also, and you have an opportunity to raise your hand. I'll allow you to speak. So do we have any questions for Neeraj, sir? I guess the things are so clear, crystal clear, that it has been very much clear to everyone. And it's really an interesting session, I would say that.
I try to keep it as simple as possible.
Yes, sir. Definitely. It was as simple because it's very basic things that we have to understand about bite marks. And once we understand the basic things, it's really an ease to work in this particular field of the forensic odontology. So with this...
There's one question. What is recognized forensic course in India? Dear Aisha, there are many recognized forensic course in India, but DCI, the Dental Council of India, does not recognize any course in India as of now. There are courses available in various universities which are definitely recognized by the UGC, University Grant Commission. JSS Mysore has one, and there are MSc courses, and especially Gujarat Forensic Sciences University has many courses and all are recognized by the UGC.
Yes, sir.
This is one of the biggest university, and I think few more states have announced to set up forensic universities now in their states after following Gujarat Forensic Science University.
Then we have one more question, sir, from Pravitha. How does the disruption of DNA evidence during bite mark analysis happens?
See, it all depends of how you keep that DNA. There are a particular methodology to take the DNA. You've taken a saliva swab. How you are going to keep that till the lab analysis are done on that? If you keep it in an open air and everybody is coming and touching that, it will definitely destroy it. So you have to be very careful while picking up the evidence from the crime scene and then preserving that evidence till it reaches to the lab. And then the investigations or lab investigations are to be done on that.
Then we have, sir, another question from Pallavi, that she's asking about that fellowship course is recognized or not. But like, that is the
no, recognized by what? Pallavi, recognized by Dental Council or recognized by UGC? No, they are not recognized. None of the fellowship courses are recognized by them. They are recognized by individual organization. Like Indian Association of Forensic Odontology have one course. Then different universities have started. They might be recognized by them, but I doubt even UGC recognizes those fellowships.
Yes.
I mean, D.Y. Patil University in Mumbai have this fellowship course. I don't have any idea rather whether they are recognized by UGC. See, D.Y. Patil University or any other university are recognized by UGC. They have power to start any course which normally are recognized by the university. But this particular diplomas, they could be recognized by university. I don't have any perfect answer for this. But if university is giving you a degree, they should be a recognized degree.
Okay, sir, there's one request also from the participant, Dr. Manish Bhagwa, that next time you could elaborate about animal bites and especially snake and dog bite marks, I guess he wanted
sure,
to.
Sure, sure, I will get, go discuss. Into the details and do that.
Okay, sir, we have one more question from Yudi, that how can we differentiate whether it's from male or female perpetrator?
See, male and female have a different set of teeth. Their line angles are different. Anteriorly, they are females have more rounded teeth than the males, mesial than the different line angles. So this can be find out. The arches are different. But all these things have to be corroborated with other evidence, like individual characteristics of the teeth. You cannot really pinpoint. It depends on the collection of the evidence. What type of whether it's if it is a clear up to the markings of the teeth, if you could able to gather that, then you can definitely do that. See, the size of the incisor width is different in males and different in females, but there is a range given in that. Okay, 12 to 14 and then 12 to 16 though, or 13 to 15. So there is a range in that. So sometimes it becomes easier, sometimes it becomes really difficult.
Okay, sir. We have
Sumedha has raised a hand. Sumedha, yes, you can ask the question.
Actually, I wanted to ask, sir, I'm a third year student, undergraduate student from Bharati Vidyapeeth Dental College, Pune. And sir, I'm willing to, do research into forensics, and I'm willing to present a research paper on that. So I was, I wish to seek your guidance about it.
You want to learn a forensic odontology, right?
Sir, yes, sir. I'm willing to publish a research paper on tongue. For as of now, I've considered the topic of tongue pens to do research on.
So, sir, very nice topic. So there's two things I could understand. Two things I can understand from your question is that. One, you want to publish a research on tongue impressions. One. Second, you are willing to learn forensic odontology through some courses.
No, sir. So yeah. for the research, I'm willing to seek your guidance.
Okay, for the research of tongue impressions.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, for the research of tongue invasion, you need to go through the articles that is related to your topic first. You have to understand what type of this thing and make sure those articles are from recognized PubMed or Scopus journal. See, there are so many journals now are available. But if you have a Scopus and a PubMed articles, you'll have a more knowledge on that.
Okay,
I have not come across any legal case as of now during through my research, which on the basis of tongue impression, any person has been, you know, convicted on the basis of those marks. I have not come across yet, but definitely there's a lot happening on the tongue impression marks on the in this field. Many most of the research is happening in this field.
Yes, sir.
So better go through the the Scopus and PubMed articles. Go through that. If you need to have any other further knowledge, and I'll share my email in the chat box. You can contact me. So I'll be able to guide you better. You know.
Thank you so much, sir.
Sir, we have a question from Sugandha also. Sugandha, you can just unmute yourself and ask the question.
Okay, sir, even my question was related to research only. So I wanted to ask regarding what all research topics we can in future prospective due because of bite marks. So what all research topics we can take?
Nowadays, the most important thing that's happening now is we as a bite mark specialist and all that, we are trying our level best to, you know, have a good training and learn more and more so that because this science was questioned a few years back, a decade back, that even some people said this is not even a science and not even a science worth presenting in the court of law. But that's not the case. As I said, there should be a good knowledge, good expertise, and then corroborated with other evidence. This is a science which can help honorable judges to reach to a proper conclusion. This could be used in a different way. It can at least establish the fact that this person was there at the crime scene. Even this can also be please take this call. This can also be done. This can also be helpful during the court of law. This is a science, a good science, but has to be presented in court of law very carefully and very efficiently.
Okay.
Irfan Muhammad has asked, how challenging is to get the bite marks in the deep cut wounds? Definitely it's very challengeable, but deep cut wounds can be recorded. The methods are similar with the polyvinyl cyclone. After you remove the blood, definitely it's difficult to record the saliva on that cut. But if there's a deep cut marks at one point, the adjacent part could give at least impression of other teeth, adjacent teeth. This is definitely very challengeable, but this can be recorded.
Then we have a question from Achal Kapoor, sir. Achal Kapoor, she wants to ask that, can you please tell me more about the tongue pressure mark?
I have not gone through in detail about the tongue pressure marks because this is a very challenging field, and recently this research have increased in this field. So I'm yet to understand and to have more knowledge on this.
Okay, then we have one question from Ruchika Divedi. She wants to ask that, what are the ethics to be taken care for dental research?
See, ethics comes from your knowledge and from your insight, what you understand. What the ethics is. If you are true and honest and you believe in, you have a good ethical value, you should always, I would always suggest that ethics, these all should be followed on that. So ethics, one second. So this ethics are related to personal view. Now, like I being a dentist, I educated from South India, so I totally believe in ethics, and there are a few dentist friends who I believe most of them 90, but there are few, very few maybe, who don't believe in ethics, like giving advertisement in the fields and all. So in every field you work in, I personally agree ethics should be followed and all that.
Okay.
If you do with honesty and all that and present your case with full knowledge, bite mark cases or any other forensic dental or forensic evidences related cases, you will definitely get the reward in that. And the example is Dr. Ranjit Singh. He's been doing into forensic ethically. I know him since last year. We went to Sudan together and I have seen him. He's been doing a wonderful work in forensic accountability. We had a lot of discussion on this topic also. So I asked him, how do you do? I mean, you get cases from different countries even. The check bounce cases, the forged signature, the bite marks, everything. He said, we have to follow the ethics and go to the court, whatever knowledge we have. And if we don't have any knowledge, we tell the court, okay, we could not record this evidence. This is not related. This is not.
Thank you, sir, for your answer. We have a few more questions, sir. There's a question from Simran Verma. She want to ask that, is bite mark evidence accepted in court India?
Yes, definitely. As I said, Nirbhaya case, it was accepted.
Yes.
Dr. Asit Acharya was the forensic odontology and he's a good friend and he's a graduate from Dharwad. I'm a postgraduate of Dharwad. He completed his degree somewhere in, I think, Australia or UK. And then he had one talk in during our postgraduate time. And then we happened to be a friend. And I did my fellowship under him only. And he even got the permission from Government of India and the court, even Supreme Court, that to show the Nirbhaya bite marks to only for research paper. He showed us the picture, did not allow us to click and all that. Very ethical, very thorough gentleman. He told us the legs, the arms of that of the deceased, and we could understand what bite marks are. I mean, that was the time where we really understood that there are so many bite marks on our body, so many. He individualized each and every bite marks, so more than 50, 60 bite marks on the body. He individualized that. He took time, individualization, comparison, analysis, then comparison, and then presented his report. Out of the five, I think five people were there or six people were there. Three bite marks he could corroborate, and but those report was corroborated with other, established the presence of the accused at the crime scene, and they got the their whatever decision in the court of law. They are accepted in Indian court of law. There's no such ruling that bite marks are not accepted.
Yes. So we have few more questions. If you allow, I can take that.
Yeah, please.
Okay. There is a question from Gaurangi that there was a famous case of Ted Bundy, the major evidence where his bite marks on the body of the victims. In that case, in
which
that situation,
case?
Ted Bundy case.
Ted Bundy, yeah.
Yes. In that situation, she want to ask that, is it possible for the forensic odontologist to be that confident with their reports and finding about like dental evidence she wants to talk about in that reference?
Sorry, I didn't get it.
I'll repeat the question, sir. She has mentioned that in the famous case of Ted Bundy, the major evidence were his bite marks on the body of the victims. There, the experts stated that the bite marks are of no one else other than Ted Bundy. Like the expert has given the opinion that it was Ted Bundy's bite mark only. So she want to ask that, is it possible for a forensic odontologist to be that confident with their report?
No, it should not. It should not be.
Yes.
Ted Bundy case happened in way back in 1976 or 79. I think he was sentenced to death. Then again, somewhere around 1986. Mm-hmm. Forensic odontology was a new branch at that time. After the Ted Bundy case, after he was electrocuted, I think in 1989 or somewhere around that. And after that case, things changed. As I said, in last decade, the things have changed totally different. Even the forensic odontology, I remember, who corroborated both of Ted Bundy cases, he was even questioned about his age. How can you say that it is this? So that's why in the last few seconds, I said that you should never pinpoint the person. You can always say it's conclusive. It's a positive conclusion. You cannot pinpoint. You are not a judge. Okay, this is the one. Hang him. No. There should be other. See, why this science was questioned? Due to cases of Ted Bundy and then Innocence Process project that happened in US, this science was questioned. And it's good that people have questioned this science. Now, this question will make this science even more better in future. Question should always be asked. So, should never pinpoint, only say, yeah, this could be this person. In last few say, I've seen, shown that there are two cars and they are similar. But we throughout our start of the BDS and then MDS and throughout, we have been teaching that no two teeth are same, right? It always happens that. We believe in that science.
Yes,
sir. Right?
Yes, sir.
So that's why you should never pinpoint that particular acute, because it's a question of his life, his freedom. If he has done any crime, there would be other evidence also. Even one more evidence other than bite mark will help the court of law to decide. Is the duty and responsibility of the court of law. Your responsibility as a forensic dentist is that you show your expertise. Okay, as per my expertise, this could be belonging to him. There is a sufficient evidence, there is an insufficient evidence, or there is no evidence. You can definitely say this does not belong to this person because evidence is totally different. If there's a missing tooth, say lateral incisor is missing and you have a bite mark where lateral incisor is present on the victim body, bite mark shows lateral incisor is present. Whereas on the accused, the lateral incisor is missing. So this does not belong to him. You have to concentrate on the individual characteristics of the teeth as well.
Thank you, sir. Then we have one more question from Pavitra. How effective are the bite marks in unfurling the crying knots? I guess she wanted to ask
they are effective to unfurling the crime knots. As I said, yes. One, it shows the presence of the, if it is almost correlated or there is a positive or possible, even a possible identification, at least make his presence at the crime scene. You can at least give one hint to the judge, honorable judge, that there is something, at least he was present in there. There are so many cases that the accused is not even present and they have been arrested. Then the trial goes on and on for years and all that. And then it comes, okay, accused was not present. Even some cases I've seen, I've gone through that. Accused presence was made by the session judge, session court, that he was present, but the High Court and the Supreme Court believes that he is not present. It depends on how you present your evidence in the court of law.
Thank you, sir. I guess you have answered this question, but still I'll repeat this question from Arvind Vidal, that do you think bite marks can stand alone to prove the guilt of a criminal?
It can if you have a sufficient evidence, like individual characteristics, like said missing central incisor. On the bite mark also there's a missing central incisor, or in anything rotated, right? Or even a fractured, individual characteristics. If in collaborated that with the bite mark, but ultimately the presence of the accused at the crime scene has to be proved. So only bite marks, you have to have other also. Alone bite marks, no, I don't think any judge, it depends on the wisdom of the judge, how he thinks. But there's a sufficiently individual evidence, you are expertise in that, and the honorable judge believes in your statement, then depends on his wisdom, it can be done.
There's one raised hand, sir, from Dr. Timur. I'll request you to unmute yourself, Dr. Timur, and please answer the whatever question you have, you can ask the question.
Thank you very much, Afrin. First of all, I must congratulate my dear fellow Dr. Neeraj on a very beautiful talk.
Thank you.
I just wanted to add few things regarding, because in Pakistan and India, we both enjoy the common law. And as there was a previous question regarding that, if this bite mark itself only can be an explicit evidence to prove somebody guilty or not. But in my belief, there is, as my friend said, that it is all about the circumstantial evidence is very important. And yes, still, we have to have a precedent to be made that bite mark could be the only evidence to prove someone guilty. And still in subcontinent, we don't have such a precedent yet. But internationally, if we see the case of Ted Bundy, he's been through so many other circumstantial evidences in his case. And if you go through that case, it's available on Google. If you go through that, he's been through DNA multiple times. They tried to prove that, but in the end of the day, it was his bite marks. But also, there are suction marks which are very important as well. So, which is also known as chiloscopy. I hope most of you have heard about it. But right now, still there is a lot of work going on. But in many states of America, bite mark, there's a lot of debate on against the bite mark as well. So when there is a debate in specific area of science, I would rather see it as a supporting evidence rather than the main evidence. This is my take on that. Thank you very much.
Sir, what's your take on, because one of the participants asked tongue impressions and all. I'm not very well versed with that. I've gone through a few researches. What's your take on that so that participant can come to know about that? I mean, you have been experienced in this. Hello? He's there or he's left?
I'll check, sir. Yes, he's there.
Himayun, sir. Temu, sir.
Neeraj, sir.
Yes. Sir, aapka, what is your take on tongue impressions? Because one of the participants asked me, I'm not very well versed with this field, and you are experienced. So, can you please answer that?
If you read through the classic imprint of a bite mark, okay. If it all depends upon the skin of the victim, actually, because usually tongue thrust always gives an impression. But yeah. In my experience, in the cases which I have been through, most of the time when there are suction marks, like in the crime of passion or in the sexual assault cases, there is an imprint of tongue. But unfortunately, as we are in subcontinent, the skin texture is different because we have multiple skin textures available in subcontinent. So it is not well recorded. But yes, on the fair skins and in the case of a very, very classical imprints of bite mark, yes, you can find that. But it is basically due to tongue thrust and it gives basically location of a bite mark or a suction mark. Only this is the important still now, which we can record through that. But specifically, again, I said suction marks are very important. Their location, it also gives an idea that what kind of a crime or could it be, with the consent or without consent. So this kind of information we can get through that.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Temur, sir. Okay, so if we do not have any more questions, do we have participants? I guess there is no more further questions, sir. So, okay, there's one more from Sumedha. She has raised her hand. Yes, Sumedha? You can just unmute yourself and ask the question.
Sir, can we please have your email
ID? Sir has shared in the chat box. Sumedha, if you could just refer that again.
And before end of the session, before ending the session, I request all the participants, as we have AFOHR, first biennial symposium of Forensic Odontology, Association of Forensic Odontology for Human Right on Rescue Right Dignity of the Dead to be held on 23rd and 24th September. I have shared the joining link. I request everyone to kindly join that symposium. That is going to be a wonderful, as we have the wonderful speakers in that particular symposium. So Neeraj sir, Temu sir, we all are the part of AFOHR. I request all
and
the
you, you'll be sorry to stop you. You'll be able to meet the creator of NNDV scale, Emilio Nuzales from Italy. He's presently the chairman of our respected organization AFOHR. So you can meet him and ask.
Yeah, I request participant. You will get the chance to interact with lots of eminent speaker and Professor Emilio, who is a chairman of president of this group. He is with his supervision, under his supervision, we are organizing this symposium. I request everyone to kindly register so that you can submit your abstract and everything. We have shared the link. And for any query, you can put your question on our website regarding this AFOHR. We will try to solve ASAP. Thank you, sir. Thank you, Neeraj sir, for a wonderful talk.
Thank you so much, Ji. Thank you.
Thank you all the participants for joining us.
Thank you so much, Neeraj sir, Ranjit sir, Temu sir, and everybody, and all the participants for being with us for today's session. It was really amazing. It was really interesting, I believe, from my side. And definitely, I believe the participants must also have enjoyed this and definitely have got to learn something new and different. With this, Neeraj sir, I'll like to present you the Certificate of Appreciation
for delivering an expert talk
on Bitemark, Unleashing the Power of Power Within. I'll request you to accept this e-certificate.
I really accept that. Thank you so much, sir,
for being with us for today's session. With everybody's permission, with Ranjit sir's permission, with Neeraj sir's permission, and with all the permission from all the participants, if there's no further question, I'll like to end the session for the day.
Thank you so much.
Thank you so much.
Thank you, Neeraj sir. Thank you, all the participants.
Thank you, Ranjit ji. Thank you, Tamu sir.
Thank you.